that we are playing Strike format, which is a little bit different from Conquest or Last Hero Standing that you might be used to. Players bring 3 decks each to the tournament. There's no class ban, but those 3 classes between them make 9 possible matchups, and then 2 of those matchups are banned from each side, creating the 5 possible matchups that you see on the right-hand side of the screen. So Silvername and Stan Sivka have both chosen to ban 2 of the matchups each, and we're left with these 5 that you see on the right. Going through the lineups very quickly, Stan Sivka has brought an Aggro Shaman, a Pirate Warrior, and Reno Mage, whereas Silvername has gone a little bit off-curve with the Dragon Warrior instead. He also has Aggro Shaman and Reno Mage as well. So starting off here, we have the Reno Mage from Silvername up against Stan Sivka's Pirate Warrior, and the Volcanic Potion pickup from Silvername early on was a very, very big deal, just contesting that early board presence. Stan Sivka, this is pretty much his last minion push, unless he can top deck his way out of this very, very well. Pick up a Corcron, some sort of smooth curve moving forward. So Silvername can start to answer some of this minion pressure here. And Stan Sivka's hand might just be running a little bit dry. And it was a card that I was about to talk about. The deck lists are public, so we can see this stuff already. And Stan Sivka will know about this inclusion already. Silvername actually going with Sogoth the Slitherer in his Reno Mage. And that's on top of Alexstrasza as well. So he has a ton of late game options available to him.
Hey, okay, I'm back.
Hey! Well, straight away, just said, yeah, we're gonna be fine today, and then disaster happened.
I've been jinxed. My setup's fine, my internet died.
Okay, there we go.
Which hasn't happened ever in this house.
All right,
I think I'm just quite unlucky this weekend. Anyway.
We are back with it. Stan Sivka has basically just got the damage train rolling with Pirate Warrior against Reno Mage. There's no Reno in hand for Silvername, and Stan Sivka is just going to try and set up lethal this turn, I imagine. I mean, if he just Mortal Strikes the face this turn, he's setting up lethal before Reno can come down with the Arcanite Reaper on the following turn, so I would expect to see it happen. Yep, there it is.
Yep, and this is kind of the case when you have Pirate Warrior against Reno Mage. Reno Mage is actually one of the better matchups for Reno Mage. This is one of the matchups you kind of want, I'm gonna say. It's not great still, but it's very easy for Reno Mage to stabilize the board early on with a lot of removal and then heal up with Reno and Ice Block and other stuff which can prevent them from killing you.
That is absolutely nutty.
Wow.
The things that had to come together, what you were talking about in this game with the early answers from the Reno Mage, that all happened. I think while you were away, there was an early Volcanic Potion, there was an early Forgotten Torch, you know, all these nice answers for the minions. And then Sivka just drew damage. He made the lethal setup in the correct way with the Mortal Strike. And then not only did Silvername have to top deck Reno to get his way out of it, he also needed that second rate Bruiser the turn before to be able to block the Arcanite Reaper.
That is an absolutely
insane sequence of events from Silvername. Definitely very, very fortunate to be making his way out of this game alive.
On 6 is just it's such a killer. Like, this is how, you need Reno in this matchup, right? We were discussing this yesterday in the same way that Reno lock against, say, Shaman, you don't necessarily need Reno to beat them. But against Pirate Warrior, if you're playing a Reno deck, you just need the heal, straight up. And yeah, it looks like it's going to be lethal for Silvername. So instead of the Pirate Warrior killing the Mage on turn 7, it's the other way around. And that way you can deal with it. But, I mean, I guess it is open decklist as well, so Status will definitely be aware of this card in Silvername's deck, so maybe he'll know that, and in that case, when he plays his Kazakus, he'll want to take at least one form of Polymorph.
Yeah, I think the revealed decklist thing is actually possibly a little bit more punishing for Stan, because Stan has Medivh as his late game tool of choice in his deck. And we see as well, looking at the lists, that I believe Silvername has an Ooze in his deck. Yes, he does. So since the deck lists are revealed, you know, Medivh is a card that you can often get value out of in the Reno Mage Mirror because it's not fully standard. So people will just play out their Ooze and then you get full Latiesh value later on. But There's no way Silvernane's playing an Ooze in this matchup. Oh, yeah. He knows the Medivh is there. So Stan Sifka basically just has a War Golem in his deck in this matchup, which is pretty depressing. Which does make me question, you know, the merit of including that card in your deck, because I think the two big strengths of it are it's good in a hidden decklist format, so in ladder or just, you know, a regular tournament, people can not expect it and you get some free wins that way. Or it can be very, very, but not very powerful, but it gives you at least some kind of win condition against J-Druid.
Yes.
And are you really expecting a lot of J-Druid in this tournament? I don't think so.
I don't
and
think
your
you
deck
are.
Lists are revealed, so that weakens the card as well. So it's a little bit weird to me to see Sifka going with that tech choice.
Well, it might be the deck he's been playing, the type of Arena Mage list he's been playing most on ladder, so he might feel more confident with this list. He might have tested it out and feels like it works well. And yeah, but I also agree, in a revealed format, if you it's not as good, right? Because if they do play weapon removal, which I think every Arena Mage should play one form of weapon removal, then yeah, they can just keep it for it. But anyway, in the game, I think nothing's really been happening, so that's good.
Hence why I've been rambling about Medivh the whole time, because Reno Mage Mirrors in the early game, not a whole lot going on, so it's a good time to just, you know, talk about the tech choices, the matchup as a whole. Stan Sifka now plays out his babbling book, and he's tried to play this on an awkward turn. He's kind of held it in his hand, had the opportunity to play it before. He's tried to play it on a turn where his opponent doesn't want to ping it, just so maybe he can get a little bit of value out of it. Turn 4 is a very common, you know, first minion turn for a Reno Mage, be it, you know, a Water Elemental, Refreshment Vendor, any of that kind of stuff. So timing his babbling book here, even though it's a very, very small incremental piece of value in terms of the body, this is a massively value-based matchup, so even those tiny pieces of value, trying to squeeze just a little bit of worth out of a 1-1 is very, very worth it.
Yeah, this matchup's really difficult because you can't just start throwing burn because then they can heal. You kind of basically have to take your opponent to fatigue in most situations, unless you can do some crazy stuff with Antonidas. That usually wins a match if you can play Emperor, discount a bunch of spells, and then play Antonidas and get all of the fireballs. But are both these players actually playing Antonidas?
I believe neither of them are playing Antonidas. Silvername is not, and Stan Sifka is not. They are both pretty much just at the shell of it. They're both, you know, pure value-based versions of this deck. Manic Soulcasters, Cabal Couriers, Cabalist Tomes, all that kind of stuff. They just kind of differ in their late-game package with the Medivh versus the Sogoth.
In that case, it's probably going to come down to some sort of Kazakus Fiesta, where potions do crazy things, or both players are going to go to fatigue, and whoever is like ahead on cards is probably in trouble.
Yeah, but or alternatively,
it's really hard to tell that.
Yeah, alternatively, Dirty Rat as well can have a huge impact.
Oh, right? If you Dirty Rat, Alexstrasza, Reno, Kazakus, that can throw the whole game plan out of the window.
Yeah, there's five, right? There's the Alex, the Reno, and then the full combo, the Bran Kazaka Soulcaster. If you can hit any part of those three as well, then you're feeling
pretty good. So. Yeah, that combo is just so many Kazakas. Kazakai everywhere.
Kazakai. I think we need an official ruling from Blizzard on the plural of Kazakas.
Yep. And, as for Silvername this turn, I don't think you really want to back a tempo Reno in this matchup. It's not the kind of... Once you do that, your opponent can just start throwing burn at your face and start pushing you down. So here, he hasn't really got many options. You could Blizzard this just to stall, but you could Frostnova Doomsayer as well. I mean, Reno Mage hasn't got a good way to clear that. And that Frostnova is from Babbling Book, so he still has one in the deck.
Now, Sifka picks up his Polymorph. Little does Silvername know that would have been a really strong Dirty Rat turn for him there, because he either hits his opponent's Rat, which is, you know, fine, or he hits the Bran, which is obviously a huge tool, but didn't really have any way to guarantee killing the thing that came out afterwards, so didn't fancy going for it. And Dirty Rat again becomes...
It's huge.
Essentially, players have just traded Dirty Rats here, which, you know, isn't a big deal, but sure.
That was the best case for Silvername, right? Any of the others would have been, like, devastating for him.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. So, pretty unlucky for Stan Sifka. He doesn't know it, but he did lose 0-1-4. He lost 3-4, actually. If you want to look at the others as high-priority targets and Dirty Rat as, like, a medium-low priority. I guess now it protects his own... You know, his own stuff. He can have no fear now that his Kazekus and Reno are going to get taken out of his hand. Which is good information to know, because sometimes you draw something and you're like, okay, do I need to play this now in case in the future it's going to get pulled out of my hand? So, yep, at least he knows this. And he's choosing to Polymorph to get rid of Doomsayer. Obviously, he wants to preserve his board, given that he's got quite a lot there.
Yeah, just going back to...
Flamestrike is a really good pickup.
It is, actually. But just going back to Silvername's decision to play the Doomsayer in the first place, I think when you play a Doomsayer in this mirror, you have to expect that one of your opponent's default responses will be the Dirty Rat if they have it available. It's just a really good time for them to play it if they don't have an answer for the Doomsayer. So the fact that, as you said, there was a 75% outcome that was pretty miserable for Silvername there if Dirty Rat
really
happens.
Miserable.
It does that make you just question a little bit whether the Doomsayer was even the right play in the first place, because he didn't really even it wasn't like he was going to drop an Emperor to follow it up. He didn't have like a huge tempo play to follow it up if it went off, so... the Doomsayer seems maybe a little bit suspect to me in that spot. But...
Yeah, I might have gone for Blizzard, which was my initial play that turn, just to stall the damage on the board, and then maybe wait until next turn. Usually when you play Doomsayer, you want to develop something after it, right? Because then you have the initiative on board. But as you said, he didn't really have much to go with it. Yeah, I mean, obviously, the worst outcome would have been Dirty Rat, and then maybe pull Alexstrasza, and then your 8-8 just dies for free. But,
yeah.
Yep. As for now, players are just going to sort of throw some things at face and pass.
Oh, you know? Reno Mage. This deck, honestly.
I mean, having Alexstrasza is pretty useful, because I think just play it now. Like, you want to do something this turn, right?
Yeah.
Or,
I think...
Like, alternatively, your game plan is to wait until after they Reno, then you Alex them.
Right, and I think that you tend to tunnel on that plan a little bit more if you're playing like the Ink Master Pyroblast, like the Rage Cycle 6-0 Burn Heavy version of the deck. If you're playing that version, you kind of want to push them down a bit, threaten lethal a little, force them to Reno, then Alex them, then burn them out at the end of the game. But burn is just not really a plan for Silvername, so I don't think the minus 15 there really even mattered for him. It's just it was either play an 8-8 or pass that turn, so he played an 8-8, essentially.
And he can't play this Ooze until later, knowing that there's Medivh in the deck, so this is also basically a dead card. And Arcane Intellect is something he can do, but does he want to draw? As I said, this matchup could go to Fatigue very easily, but... he hasn't got much to do.
Difka did already play a Drake this game, so he's drawn some cards himself, which might give Silvername a little bit of permission to go for the Arcane Intellect. Both players know that, you know, the Fatigue is essentially a tie because they are both playing Manic Soulcaster and they're both playing Forgotten Torch. That's something that you do really have to calculate in a Fatigue-based matchup. Like, if nothing happens, who has the initiative in the first place if neither player draws cards? And in this case, it's just a complete tie. The player who is going second will be slightly unfavored, which, as we can see, was Stan Sifka. So the fact that Stan Sifka already played his Drake means that Silvername can play the Arcane Intellect, and they're essentially back at square one. Because, as I said, Stan Sifka has the coin, therefore went second, and has drawn one extra card naturally anyway.
Yeah, and Silvername's hand wasn't really doing much, so I don't mind drawing that either.
Yep.
Now he's got a lot more to do. Like, Sogoth is going to be really good because we haven't seen Kazekus yet. So there's just no way for Stan to deal with this apart from minions or his own Doomsayer. But Doomsayer can get cleared by this Forbidden Flame. So there's definitely answers for a potential like counter Doomsayer. But there's Kazekus right on time. And here comes Bran Kazekus.
Bran has Cabal Courier is available.
That's a lot of value.
So let's see, he will have, six cards in his hand afterwards, and he's going to draw four. So he'll have to coin nothing unless he takes a one-mana potion off the Kazekus if he doesn't want to overdraw in this spot. And we'll see what he goes for. Picks up, I mean, that is, you're at 10 mana, that's just a 3-mana, 3-5 taunt, so seems reasonable.
And he's already seen the Doomsayer, so Shadow of Pain isn't as useful, because there's not that many targets for it. But there's still a few, there's still Bran, there's still some other stuff, but yeah. Mews is so much value, he's choosing to take a 10-mana potion first, and then another 10-mana potion.
Let's take double 10, so it looks like we're just going to see coin nothing at the end of this turn, as long as I haven't catastrophically miscounted the hand size. But no, that looks good to me, it's going to have to be a coin nothing.
Yep. I didn't quite see what all those potions were, but now we're going to see quickly.
10 armor, 3 demons, and summon an 8-8 polymorph all, I think, are the potions.
That's usually you want Vary summon and keep your minions health. I think that's the most important one. But I guess he wasn't offered it. But armor demons isn't that good. Armor's okay since he's on quite low health.
Yeah.
But three demons, like, your hand's already full. You don't really. It's a lot of value in the late game. Sometimes you just get a Krull or a Doomguard. It's like, or a Jiraxis. It could even be useful. But sometimes you get two Blood Imps and a Flame Imp.
Yeah, more often than not, demons are not that great. You kind of get, like, Imp Gang boss quality on average. That's about, like, the mid-roll of a demon, so you're getting three cards around that power level on average. Like, sure, sometimes you hit Jiraxis and that's amazing, but demons definitely one of the lesser sought-after choices.
And he's leaving Bran alive, knowing that he's seen these battle cries already. He's like, yeah, I'm going to get this face damage in and put you in range of, like, a lot of outs, right? Or there's not too many outs, but there's some worlds where he can find lethal.
Yeah, especially since his 5-9 just has a reasonable chance of sticking on the board because it's, you know, untargetable. So he only has to follow that up with a Roaring Torch that he's already played, a Frostbolt, you know, all of those things can represent lethal.
Yep, so it looks like Stan's going to be forced to either gain armor or polymorph, but if he polymorphs, it's his whole turn. Oh, he could also Frost Nova. This is also fine.
Frost Nova Cabal Chemist. Interesting. So again, he's going to run into hand size issues. He's going to have to play something after this. Potion of Polymorph is what he chooses to go for.
And I mean, Silvername left Bran alive, knowing that there's not really any more battle cries left, which he's worried about. But then, Stan Sifka had got this from the courier earlier.
I'm sure he would have loved a greater healing potion in that spot.
Oh, and that would
have
been
two
insane
shots at it. But yeah, no such luck. So he's kind of just trying to dig through to his Reno now at this point.
Yep, Stan has so much value in his hand. If he can just heal up, I think he'll be pretty good for the rest of the game.
I mean, it's not a value shy hand on the other side either, to be perfectly fair. I mean, he does have the Cabal Courier, the Bran is waiting there for the Kazakus, Emperor and Drake as well.
The moment Silvername draws Kazakus, it's typically factor even again. And he's on almost full health, and Stan is on 9 health, so yes. This turn, Emperor seems pretty good with his hand. Like, you have a lot of stuff which is even better when you discount it. But it just gets polymorphed.
Savage.
And potentially he could have tried to play around this by maybe playing the other minions first.
Well, it's interesting. If the rest of his turn now is going to be, say, you know, Cabal Courier or Manic Soulcaster, his Sogoth, then this is just incorrect, right? Because it's worse against Mirror Entity, it's worse against Potion of Polymorph, but it looks like he was just planning to go for a removal turn the whole time, in which case that was the only minion he was going to play, and honestly, just unlucky.
I mean, this makes sense, right? Because you have these Battle Cries in hand, you want to save them for Bran. You don't want to play the Ooze either.
Yeah, sure.
So there's not really any minion you'd want to play that turn other than Emperor. But then it was the situation. Wait a second. We should have known it's Potion of Polymorph, right? If he's paying attention to where the cards came from. Because the secret came from the chemist.
Oh, you're absolutely right.
So he should have just known that it's been a Polymorph. So that is just a misplay, I think.
You are absolutely correct, yeah. So, Reno Mage happens and there's a random secret and it's just a random secret. But that wasn't a random secret, that was a random potion.
No, that
potion
was always Potion of Polymorph.
Yeah, you're absolutely correct. Interesting. So, maybe he even knew that and just decided the Emperor was the least important card in his hand.
That's
There's
also
an argument.
Possible.
That is actually a real argument, right?
Well, given these other Battlecries cards, which are just insane with Bran, that could definitely be the case. I feel maybe you could have just played the Courier there and then played Emperor because... discounting this hand is also pretty good.
Yeah. And really interesting
see the
10
armor
interaction,
and 3
though,
demons.
Those last few turns.
And are these demons good? Okay, but he doesn't get. He misses one because his hand is full. But he did need the armor desperately, given that he's on low health and hasn't drawn Reno yet.
Yeah, and he had to miss the demon there as well. The only other card he could expend from his hand was the Forbidden Flame, which obviously he cannot cast first because of the way the Forbidden mechanic works. So he just dumps it afterwards for zero damage in order to make room for the next card that he draws, which he'll be. Really hoping is Reno Jackson sooner rather than later in this spot.
Into a rough spot for Stan Sifka. His hands are just full of stuff he can't play because he's on low health and his opponent's pressuring him.
Soulcaster
has got some taunts.
Does. A double Felguard now, in fact.
He can play lots of Felguards.
Playing two Felguards in the same turn, though, will actually impact his mana, whereas playing them one at a time won't, yes. Which is kind of interesting. But the Soulcaster pick up now, but doesn't really have the ability to like super heavily load his deck for fatigue, since the Bran is gone now at this point. And so a fatigue battle at this point, probably coming down to Silvername. I'm not sure exactly what the deck totals are at this point, if we could get a look at that at some point, but I would suspect it's going in favor of Silvername.
Yeah, and Silvername hasn't got a really clean answer to this. Actually, he does with the Thalnos, yeah. So he can just take this up and still remain on board. And again, Stan has not drawn Reno yet, so he hasn't got time to play these huge like value cards.
Sivka's still digging. His one remaining potion now is the Polymorph plus Summon an 8-8, I think, the remaining one in hand. He ended up not having to polymorph the Sogoth. The Sogoth still got incredible value from him. It took out a volcanic, it took out a minion, it connected face for 5, and it ate Volcanic Potion and Flame Strike.
And a Frost Nova.
Yep. That's very true. That's insane. Like, that's a legitimate 5-for-1 plus some damage. That's incredible value from Sogoth.
And this Potion of Madness might actually be good, because it allows you to get the spell damage needed for the Arcane Blast to clear off the 4-5. Doesn't mean you draw a card, but I think you want to draw Reno at this point. So, drawing a card is probably fine. Of course, fatigue is something to consider, but how else are you going to deal with this 4-5? You could Fireball it. You probably want to save Fireball for another target, but he's going to do this. Okay. He's realizing he can maybe get more value out of the potion, or he doesn't want to draw that card.
Yeah, and I would love it if production could just mouse over the decks for us to give us that information on the cards left, because that is incredibly important.
It's
now
getting
that
quite important.
Now that Stan Sivka has started to stabilize in this game, it doesn't look like Silvername's going to get there by pure damage, so we might be re-entering the fatigue situation now.
Void Torch is a good pickup as well. Allows him to easily clear this. He's just going to go for the Polymorph now? No. I don't know. I think you'd rather just clear this minion with one of your spells. Or even just leave it up and play some more stuff.
It's interesting because the native big threats in the deck are all gone. He's dealt with Sogoth, he's dealt with Alexstrasza, you know, he's dealt with kind of all this big stuff. The Kazakus has not been seen yet. So if Kazakus suddenly picks up a big revive potion, then you're going to need that potion of polymorph to counter it. So I would expect Sivka to hold on to it for that reason.
Yeah, because you need to hold on to that.
It does seem like this game's going all the way to 30 cards versus 30 cards, right? So that interaction will probably happen at some point.
Yeah, and I'm going to say it's looking pretty tough to stand, given that eventually Silvermane will get the double Kazakus and then put two Kazakuses back in his deck. And at that point, there's just so many potions. I don't know if Stan will be able to outvalue, but he has drawn Reno, so he can finally heal up a bit. But at this point, it doesn't really help, because the rest of his hand isn't doing much. He can play Reno and then Shadowcaster it, so that he gets another Reno. But yeah, based on how this game's planned out, I think if Silvername's last card isn't Kazakus, he's probably in a pretty good spot.
Yeah, the drawing the Reno is important. Silvername did recognize that he'd just fallen a bit short. We've seen him using Burn on removal over the last few turns. Forgotten Torch was fired at the minions, so he's not on the all-out face plan. And we've just got word from production now. There are 8 cards remaining in Silvername's deck, 6 remaining in Stan Sivka's. So Sivka is actually in a serious mess here. He needs to make something happen as rapidly as he can, because he is losing the fatigue battle as well.
He needs to draw Medivh and then just hope something's going to happen, but there's Vuse waiting, and he must know Vuse is waiting as well, so. That's his late game win condition. It is Medivh, it's his highest mana card, but I don't think it'll be enough at this point. If he could have somehow Emperored and then play Medivh and Manic Soulcaster on Medivh, then potentially he could have done some crazy stuff with the second Atiosh. But does he still have Emperor in his deck? I think he does.
I believe he does still have Emperor available, yeah.
So that could potentially be a line.
I like it.
And then the second Atiosh gets lots of value because you can't lose both of them.
That is a very interesting possibility.
Home as well is also really, well, it's just good in this matchup, right? It's just a lot of value.
Yeah, I think Sifka still has a tome to come from his deck as well. Let me just double check that Sifka is in fact playing a tome as well.
I'm pretty sure he is also playing a tome, yes.
Yeah, yes he is.
But it's awkward to play when your hand's so full.
It is, for sure. I'm really interested in that Medivh Soulcaster line though, because even if Stan Sifka does that, Silvername even has the possibility, like, say he's down to his last two or three cards in his deck, he can ooze Soulcaster his ooze in response to it, and then try and deal with the second Atiesh by drawing the ooze in his last couple of cards. So yeah. The game can actually get a little bit silly if the players decide to go down that line. It's definitely an interesting possibility for Sifka to consider. Because yes, it sounds a little bit ridiculous, but Sifka is unfavored in any normal world that you look at right now. So he has to come up with something a little bit weird to get himself out of this.
Yeah, I agree. Of course, his Cavalis Tome could provide a lot of value. There's some insane spells you can get from Mage, which is going to potentially turn the game around. Even just a lot of burn, like double Pyroblast, let's say. It's just 20 damage, which at this point in the game, when you're just pinging, like the past four turns have just been pinged past.
Yeah, like, and the reason for this, like, yeah, sure, they have some cards that they can play. You know, Silvername could have portaled Face, Sifka could be playing Mind Control Techs and Void Terrors, but when you come down to a pure fatigue situation like this, you're literally trying to allocate every single card in your deck for the best possible scenario. So you don't want to play cards for potentially very little value. You don't want to Firelands Portal Face because that can be used to take care of a Refreshment Vendor, for example, that Silvername still knows is in Sifka's deck.
This Doomsayer is good because it forces Silvername to play a card, right? And he can't play a minion into it because he just dies.
Right.
Silvername had 10 cards, the Doomsayer forces a sort of card. So now he's just wasted that potion. But I think, yeah, Silvername's okay with that. The potion probably wasn't going to get much value anyway.
Now Sifka is in a rough spot because, you know, as we were mentioning before, as soon as he plays a minion here, he sort of activates potential plays from Silvername's hand to be able to respond to it. And this is, again, one of the reasons why they've been so timid in terms of playing cards. He's now forced to play out a minion just to prevent burn. That means Silvername now has a much easier turn as to how to do the same thing. There it is.
It was the last card. But now his hand's too full to actually do the combo. I mean, you can still do it, and then you can... maybe you can take a one-mana potion, even, just so you can play something this turn. Because once he does this, his hand is full, right?
Yes. But he can also know what his last card is, right? And decide that he doesn't need it, and just choose to
burn it.
Oh,
no, he can play the Manic Soulcaster, of course. Yeah, no, this is fine. It's
worked
out perfectly.
You're absolutely right. Also, just note, Silvername just got the Almost Out of Cards alert. Did Sifka run out of cards already, or were we given the wrong information?
I think it was the wrong way around, I believe.
But still, either way, the fact that in that case that Sifka was two cards ahead or behind, whichever way you want to look at it, it now means that he's caught up in terms of deck size with that Manic Soulcaster. So he's still kind of back in control of proceedings.
Yeah, and I guess this is some sort of line. He was saving the potion madness to deal with Bran, knowing that Bran would come out eventually. That's why he didn't play earlier.
Now he can Manic Soulcaster something to push himself back in front in fatigue, so...
There's nothing really good to Soulcaster.
Well, it doesn't matter, right? He just needs the cards in his deck. It doesn't really matter what they are, as long as they are in there and preventing him from dying to fatigue at this point.
Yeah, because he is be quite far ahead. I mean, I think he hasn't even seen the notification yet where he's almost out of cards.
Right.
So I assume Stan has like 4 or 5 cards left, whereas Silvername has 2.
Yeah, it means when we were told it was Silvername had 8 cards and Sifka had 6, that it was the other way around. So Sifka would have been 2 cards ahead, Silvername would have evened it up with the Soulcaster, and then Sifka would have gone 2 cards back ahead with his own Bran Soulcaster in that spot. So that's what
I like
suspect
this when you,
to be the case.
I like this when you steal the Bran and you eat it.
Sick.
But it actually gets it twice, it's not right.
Gets the double buff, 13-11. You never played Bran Void Terra Zunis? That never happened.
Unfortunately,
to you?
I don't think I have, sorry.
Okay.
I mean, I played a lot of Zoo, but I don't think I ever played Bran and Void Terra in the same deck.
Okay. It's really bad, but I have tested it.
Yeah.
It's terrible.
So this probably requires the Polymorph, right? Because there's a 13-11.
Yeah.
But alternatively, you can play Kazuka's first, just see what potion you can get. There's just so many potions going around.
They really are.
Yeah, he's picking another 10 mana potion. So he's just going to say, right, my next three turns are going to be 10 mana potions, okay?
Yeah, as soon as this game breaks down, as soon as there's like a moment of rest, then we'll see people just starting to go off with 10 mana potions. And yes, Sivka has really, really cleverly engineered a situation where he's ahead on fatigue by, you know, holding on to that potion of madness for the brand, using the Soulcaster. So the inevitability is now on his side. But basically, the hands are very, very similar, except one person... One person has 10 mana potions and the other person has mind control techs in their deck, but
no, the other
two pyroblasts.
Two 10 mana pyroblasts. That's what I said earlier. Literally said two pyroblasts. Now, here they are. I am a prophet. I'm a wizard.
Is Silvername now going to read into this? Not read into it, but at least, you know, be potentially safe due to the threat of that Cabalist Tome now. And it looks like he is. He's going to pass up a 10 mana potion this turn, instead just go for a nice safe Reno in this situation. Would have died even if the one
he would have died, yeah,
just to that Pyroblast.
But those Pyroblasts are really important because that's just 20 damage, and your opponent is already now taking damage from fatigue. And Vesemir as well. Unfortunately, he can't do what I said earlier, because he hasn't drawn his Emperor yet. But, yep, he's going to play Medivh, and unfortunately the Ooze is going to come down, but there's still a 7-7 he has to deal with, and he might get some good minion from this Frostbolt. Not, hopefully... Yeah, it's okay.
Yeah, I mean, he
and
I
like this choice.
He has to get value out of it, because he knows it's getting so,
yeah. Yeah.
Like Vesemir, in fact, well. Doesn't even play Emperor in his deck, by the way.
Oh, he doesn't, so he can't do the funky play. Oh, yeah. Unfortunately not. Okay. But, I mean, those Pyroblasts, this game's pretty even now.
It really is.
Are any of those potions gain armor? Because, I mean, we can't tell right now, but I think it's quite important that they are. One of them needs to be. Because these Pyroblasts can just start burning Silvername down.
And now Sivka gets his almost out of cards alert, draws another mind control tech, of course, since there's so many of them in his deck. The other two additional ones, and he has to find some way. He just needs like one big minion to connect with face here, and it might be that 8-8 at this point. This is where he really needs to have been tracking his opponent's options, and yes, your opponent has three potions in hand. So in that case, how do you get a minion to stick to the board to hit Silvername in the face?
Yeah, it's really tough. He's going to play the Mind Control Tech, Vendor. I think playing Vendor now is good, because you don't want to heal him later. Yeah, healing him for now is fine. It's much more important than healing him for four. But yeah, I think one of his potions is going to come down now. I can't really tell what any of them do.
I have no idea what Silvername picked. Unfortunately, the way Spectator Mode works, we don't really even see them mousing over what they were picking. So, no indication as to what the top player's potions were, but...
Instead, he wants another 10 mana potion. He just wants to have all of them in his hand.
Why not? All I've ever wanted is to have, 48 mana in my hand. 58 mana even, sorry, with the fourth potion as well, yeah.
Mistress of Mixtures is not the card you want as your last card. Yeah, I think this is the line. This is the line. You have to burn him down. I hope there's no armor. And if there is no armor... Silvername's in trouble. He hasn't got time to just...
Four
like,
potions
crush it down
with no armor?
Stand.
What are the chances?
Yeah,
there it is.
Pretty,
no, that
pretty
was
low.
No armor.
Okay, that one definitely has armor.
Oh, that's
that one does
armor
as well.
As well.
Okay. Okay. After that, it's going to be pretty rough for Stan.
Yeah. Because,
He's waiting for his polymorph until after resummon. So he's choosing, do I polymorph now or do I burn face? He's either playing around resummon or armor.
He's also trying to play around Counterspell potentially as well. And Spellbender at the same time by targeting face. You know, I think the reason he went for the Kaz on the previous turn is that he was scared of Counterspell. No choice at that point. He knows he's dying to second Pyroblast. He knows he's dying to a form of Burst plus another Fatigue Tick anyway, so he has to take the risk.
Yep, and now it's... Yeah, I don't think Stan can win this, because Silvername will find a way to stand low enough so that the next key tick he takes will be lethal, even though he has got Ice Block. Well, he can freeze the board, he can transform them all into sheep, but yeah, there's going to be the damage from the Firelance portal, plus the sheep and the thing to end of the game. I don't think there's any way out for San Sifka.
I don't see it. If he frees it, how much did Sifka fatigue for this turn? The one?
One. So if he does freeze, I think he is okay.
But no, Firelands portal ping will kill him, right?
Yeah, no, but still, okay, yeah. Okay, good. Yeah, it's still lethal.
Yeah, Silvername would just have to find a way to deal less than 8 damage, essentially, to, between 6 and 8 damage to end the game, to either tick of fatigue, breaking through the ice blocks.
Yep, and Firelance Portal will end the game with the ping, because it means Stan will take 2 damage from fatigue next turn. Ice Block does not activate on your turn, only on your opponent's turn. So, and there's a Doom card, just in case you needed more damage.
Actually could have thrown the game for Silvername. If he'd have attacked with the Doom Guard first, it actually would have not been lethal due to this tick being for 2 fatigue and not 3.
Yeah.
There you go, a refreshing change, I'd say, from yesterday, where we just saw Patches going back and forward all day and 2016 competitively. He won WCA in 2016, he was also second in IEM Katowice, which was one of the first major tournaments I cast last year as well.
Yep.
So he's actually a very, very accomplished competitive player, as you might be able to tell by clearly his profile picture there being at an esports event with the lit up background. He's no stranger to these big tournaments. He knows what he's doing, despite, you know, primarily being categorized as the huge streamer for the Russian community.
Yeah, and not only that, his hand's also pretty good, I'd say.
That helps too, yeah.
Yeah, it turns out the Buccaneer and Zoss first mate are pretty good when you draw them on turns 1 and 2. Now he can just probably go for the monkey here. I don't mind this either, because the Trog, it contests the board pretty well, and the monkey puts Trog like a stop to it.
Yeah, since Sifka overloaded for one, you're considering Totem Golem and Flame Tongue as basically your two possibilities. Totem Golem does very little on this board. It's actually actively pretty bad on this board to play Totem Golem. And Flame Tongue's just fine. Like, yeah, sure, it trades 4-3 into 3-4 at that point, but then there's just a heavily exposed Flame Tongue totem left over. So, yeah, Monkey looked perfect in that situation. And this
he picks up the other one drop in his deck to fill out the curve perfectly.
This was, I want to ask you about this actually, because this was, you know, very popular conventional wisdom for a while, was that Dragon Warrior was one of the best counters to aggressive shamans. And it's kind of tailed off recently. I haven't really seen that much Dragon Warrior being played apart from, say, Orange, who's been really successful with it recently. Why do you think people have gone, you know, almost full cycle back to pirates more often than the dragons these days?
I used to play a lot of Dragon Warrior too, but I think some of the changes they made to, like, they nerfed some cards, so they nerfed Execute, which was previously used in Dragon Warrior, and now it's 2 mana, it's kind of trickier to play. Mm. Also, the addition of these pirates, once the new pirate deck came around, it just felt stronger, like, it had more early game, it had more damage overall, it just had so much burn in the deck with all these weapons. Dragon Warrior, sometimes you don't draw the dragons, sometimes you draw all the things which require dragons and not actually the dragons. And against Shaman, they got some new cards like the Jade Lightning and some other mid-range cards which can help them in this matchup.
Right, yeah.
I'm not too sure exactly why it fell off, but yeah.
Jade Lightning is super good in this matchup, I will say. Just like sniping Blackwing Corruptors, sniping Azure Drakes, like Jade Claws plus Jade Lightning to hit Twilight Guardian, all that kind of stuff. Like, it's really, really powerful.
Oh yeah, it's insane. So that might be a big reason why things have changed slightly. Because previously you'd have to Lava Burst their big guys, like Azure Drake or something. Yeah. But now you just play something and it doesn't overload you and it makes a 2-2 or 3-3 or etc. I think you're a lot happier with that. But this Jay Lightning isn't too much value, it's just on Finley, but it is kind of necessary to clean up the board. His hand is pretty awkward. Like, Feral Spirits wouldn't have done much there, it just dies to the weapon and to the Buccaneer. And having ping is also really useful.
Yeah. Where is this Corruptor going? He does choose to shoot it on the 1-1, doesn't get fully aggressive. Okay, he's going to swing the axe, so it's essentially the same thing. He wants to set up that Corruptor.
Yeah, but Jay Lightning number 2 is going to come down, but it still means that you can come down, and Silvername's hand is it's good enough to just win this game soon.
Gonna say, now, you just need to find a turn 7, and as your Drake, even if it whiffs on the draw itself, Drake plus ping is gonna do just fine for his turn 7, so looking unbound in really good shape. That's an unbound elemental!
That's not a card we normally see, but Stan? Yeah? I mean, I guess Townfall, I mean, okay, Tusk of Totemic got nerfed. Maybe he feels you need another free drop to fill out the curve.
I know,
it's not terrible. Azixo tried it a little bit.
Way back in the day when Aggro Shaman was Mech Shaman, essentially. The first few lists that came out, I remember Reynad then came out with a list that had Unbound Elemental in it. And I think that was one of the decks that he hit rank one legend with the few times that he's done it recently. So it's a card that's kind of been on the fringes, but definitely not a popular choice, even in the aggressive decks. But left unchecked, it definitely can get out of control very quickly.
Yeah, it's like a worse Chog. But Chog is so good, maybe you want to play another one.
Yeah, I mean, I would play 6 Chogs in my deck if I could, that seems fine.
And this Flame Tongue placement is kind of awkward, because he's traded in a bit, but now it's... Yeah... Luckily, the Fel Spirits and the Taunt Totem are going to stall this Crusher long enough to stabilize the board for set Stan. Oh, what? It's such a good pickup.
I said even if the Drake whiffed, then Drake ping would probably be fine, but the Fiery War Axe is just perfect in that spot. And now with double Drake Rag as his hand, he's actually potentially winning on value, even though his aggression has been shut down now. Now it's looking like Sifka possibly is the player more likely to win just with pure aggression. And Sylvanane is going to play the grindy game with Rag taking out minions, Azir Drake just drawing more resources. Like, this is looking very grim from Sifka from either perspective.
Yeah, this Rag, I think you're okay with anything it hits. Obviously, the Unbound Elemental is the best target, but even just face puts your opponent in range of dying next turn. Flame Tongue's probably the worst target, so that's pretty good for Stan. Second Fel Spirits is huge, because it's 2 minions, so Rag is just worse, right?
Mm-hmm.
This is huge, and now he can start pushing, and soon he might be able to find lethal of his own, and swinging here is definitely correct. Next turn, he has a few outs to just win the game, assuming Rag, like, hits a bad target. Ghoul's pretty good, because you can... Oh, wow. Because with the Ichor, it means you can take out the totem. Yeah, this is good. Just taking out a minion, means that your Rag has a high chance of hitting a high priority target. Hitting face? Oh, is that as lethal?
On the previous turn, Sylvanane could have killed one of the Spirit Wolves instead of
the ping, yeah.
The spell damage totem does take 2 damage off the board anyway because it reduces the power of the Spirit Claws. Plus, it has the potential to add...
Pirate Warrior Mirror. Actually, it was Dragon Warrior versus Pirate Warrior.
Yes,
and
indeed.
This matchup should be favored for Dragon Warrior, I believe, because they have a few taunts and they have the early game still. Like, Fierce Monkey and Guardian are pretty annoying for a deck which just wants to rush you down.
Yeah, I think, again, that was kind of conventional wisdom that when Patches was released, the cycle that we saw was that the really, really aggressive deck put Buccaneer in, put Patches in, etc. So Aggro Shaman and Pirate Warrior, they started playing it first. And then Dragon Warrior, which is a little bit slower, they found room for that package as well. And then everyone said, okay, this is better because it counters the Shaman and the Pirate Warrior. You have the same aggressive start, but then you scale better later on. But for some reason, Dragon Warrior has kind of disappeared. Whereas you would expect, if we're saying that it's good against Shaman and it's good against Pirate Warrior, why isn't it the most popular deck on ladder, right? Like, it just would be. So there's obviously something going on where it's not as good as a lot of people tend to think it is.
Yeah. When we say it's good, it's probably only like 1% better than it's like 51% versus 49 or something.
Sure.
This hand from Sylvanane's good, but it's a little slow, whereas Dan, he's got the double cultist in hand, but no weapon, unfortunately. Mm-hmm. But this subsea captain is getting work done. It's just buffing up these pirates, and there's no easy way for Sylvanane to deal with them.
Yeah, and I think this is one of the additions that maybe changes the matchups a little bit, is that Pirate Warrior is now more equipped than it used to be to play for the board.
I agree completely, yeah.
Yeah, normally, if the early aggressive minions just traded off, then Pirate Warrior just had no board plays later on, and then Twilight Guardian, Blackwing, Corruptor, etc. would just come down and crush everything. But now you have South Sea Captain, sometimes you have that Naga Corsair as well, so you just have like an extra chunky 5/4 body in your deck. And I think that's a big part of the reason why Pirate Warrior is finding itself more competitive against these more mid-rangey decks these days.
Wow. And picking up a free 0 mana 3 is pretty good on this turn. If you just want to play the Reaper, that is. But you could consider just playing some other stuff. You could play the Corcoran, put pressure on the board, because you can always play the Reaper next turn. But I think I like on curve just playing the Reaper now. Then next turn you can upgrade it because you have the pirate in hand and you have the other cultist. What do you think? Reaper and Dread Corsair?
Reaper Dread Corsair definitely looks much more appealing now that he did draw the 0 mana 3-3, as you said. And the curve works out fairly well. He's like a tiny bit mana efficient next turn, mana inefficient next turn. For that reason, you can even choose to hold on to the 0 mana 3-3 here, just not to put it into the axe.
It's kind of an
old school Patron Warrior play as well, where you'd hold the 0 mana Dread Corsair in your hand deliberately for the second charge of Death's Bite, so you would activate the Battle Rage guaranteed straight away. So that kind of thing, like, yeah, it's a 0 mana card, that doesn't mean you have to slam it straight away. Like, the fact that it's free means that you can just hold on to it to get value out of whenever
It's a free Taunt, that's the important thing. It has Taunt, so it protects your other stuff. And this turn, really strong from Dantisca, getting to buff up his weapon and taking out this such a clean kill and developing the Frothing. Like, somebody's going to have real trouble dealing with all of this. And these crushers are just 6/6s. They don't do anything.
It was really strong to begin with, but then that ghoul pickup just blew that turn apart. Like, that extra pressure that he got out of it was just insane.
Yeah. And now, is that lethal? I think that is lethal.
Corcoran plus a rogue strike looks good to me.
Yeah, that's a lot of damage. So it would be one off, but with the Herc strike pickup, that is it.
This Dragon Warrior that Silvername has brought is proving to be the a little bit of a sticking point for him right now. He's a sticking point for Stan Sifter, if you like. Sorry, he's already picked up one loss with that deck, so he's going to have to find a way through the Dragon Warrior here, and perhaps a little bit better equipped to go long-term against a Reno Mage than a Pirate Warrior is. Like, we say that the Pirate Warrior matchup is just very polarized, Reno or no Reno. The Dragon Warrior matchup probably more about Kazakas, like whether they can get a huge potion out of that than it is just straight up about Reno.
Yep. And maybe Dragon Warrior will get 3-0'd here, which it would be pretty sad. It's always sad when you're 2 up and in your last deck every time and lose every time. But yeah, his hand's good. He's got the curve. He's got a decent curve going into the game. Mm. But there's Kazakus, and Kazakus can put a huge dent in your plans, as we've seen many times.
Arcane Explosion, probably not going to be the most effective tool against Dragon Warrior. Their minions are just kind of too chunky to get impacted by that, even with spell damage. Picks up the Frothing, which allows him to hold on to his coin. He did have coin 4/4 available to him anyway, but goes for the early threat of the Frothing. You know, very similar to the Reno Lock matchup. If there's no direct answer to it, it's one of the minions that really can snowball games for you. It's one of the minions that can win you a game even when your opponent has Reno, if they're unable to answer a Frothing Berserker.
Unfortunately, there's loads of ways which you can actually deal with this.
There is a lot, yeah.
But, I mean, Silvername's curve is pretty good. Next turn he has a 4-drop, then a 5-drop. He picks him a 2-drop, his turn 6 is 4-2, and then he can coin rag. And that's pretty hard to deal with unless there's some sort of way to deal with it from Kazakus, maybe. Or possibly Spell Power, Fireball, and Ping. Or Polymorph, that's also good.
Sorry, this play that Sifka made is actually incredibly clever as well, because he covered both of the likely options for an on-curve play from Silvername. He covered Corcoran Elite, where he would just have Arcane Blast and Arcane Explosion available to him. He also gave himself the option to take care of the 3-6 as well, if he wanted to spend his whole turn doing that. But more importantly, just those 2/0/2 taunts in the way, they kind of challenge the 3-6 anyway, so buys himself time against that either way. But the really big deal is that he played around a Corcoran Elite really, really effective there by leaving the Frothing at 1 health and giving himself potential Arcane Explosion value on the following turn.
Yeah, I really like that play, and it's not one I would have considered. I probably would have just used removal there to get rid of the Frothing, because usually you're quite scared of it, but freezing it means you can deal with it the next turn, and I like the line he chose. Whereas now, his hand, Arcane Explosion doesn't do much. Kazakus is probably the play, and see what you can find. And he picks a 5 mana, which I probably would go for as well.
Yeah, takes the 5.
5-5 demon.
I imagine he took 5-5 in that spot, yeah. As and we said, it's very hard to say with the spectator mode. But yeah, deal 5, summon a 5-5. Just a big tempo play in this matchup. That's what you're looking for. Ideally, he wanted the 4 damage AoE, of
course.
Yes,
the AoE is huge.
That's the juice, as TJ would say. But in this situation, the big tempo play of, you know, basically a one entire mid-range minion board swing is what that card represents. You can kill 5 health and summon a 5-5, so... still pretty solid.
Yep. And he has got the ice block developed, if I'm correct. So he's not in any fear of dying too soon, because there's chances that after you get low enough and the ice block is stopped, you can play Reno to heal back up. He's going to choose the ping here.
I'm not fully sold on the ping. I actually liked the Arcane Explosion that turn quite a lot, because he would have left a 3-5 and a 4-2 on the board. And then on the following turn, your potion snipes the 3-5 and your arcane blast snipes the 4-2, and then you try and regain some of the control of the board that way. This way, he needs to kind of a potion, arcane blast, and ping all in the same turn to be effective, which he's not able to do because it costs 8 mana, so...
Well, it means he can just leave the Guardian alive, right? So instead, he's going to do this and use ping on the court phone. And I guess the Guardian's only representing 3 damage, so it's not as big a deal, but... he can always deal the 1 damage to it later after it can be traded in.
Yeah, fair enough.
Curator is huge. The amount of value you get from that card is really good in a matchup like this. And now Silver Name just has the hand to keep going and going.
Yeah, he's actually now officially outvaluing the Reno Mage, which is a very strange situation. But this is... it's a phrase that I first heard Zalay using that I really, really like. Zalay is talking about something aggro decks do, and it's the value of going face, which sounds weird, right? Because hitting face, playing aggressive minions, attacking your opponent directly, that's not a value play. It's an aggressive play. It's a tempo play. But what you do when you do that is you deny your opponent's value cards. So if you're being aggressive, Sifka can't play Kazakus and take a 10 mana potion. He can't brand Kazakus and get huge value that way. He doesn't have time to sit back and draw cards. So by being aggressive, you reduce the value that your opponent is able to gather, and you can actually then beat them on value anyway, which is kind of absurd. And that's exactly what we've seen this game.
Yeah, speaking of aggression, now we just have Hunter Hero Power. So.
Yeah. Hunter Hero Power and a 9-9. Let's go.
Yeah, and Cavalla's Tome, is it going to do anything? Oh, Cone of Cold is pretty good. Just to prevent 9 damage from face, and it clears off some of his minions.
Yeah, he does have to pause and think just a little about whether he's able to effectively deal with that Draconid Crusher next turn. So he could have polymorphed it this turn just to get it out of the way directly, but by using the Cone of Cold, he still commits to having to deal with it the next turn. But I think between the polymorph, the possibility of mind control tech, which is now a reality, and that Forbidden Flame that he picked up as well, he feels like not dealing with it is a risk that he's willing to take.
Blizzard's also a really good pickup. Let's see if we can steal that 9-7. The worst one. It's unfortunate. So now we have to see the polymorph come out. Oh, Blizzard actually is fine because it still can't attack. But I think we should consider Ice Lancing now. Now he's setting up for that Arcane Explosion, that's for sure. Yeah.
Finally finding some value potentially out of that Arcane Explosion on the following turn, but the hits keep on coming from Silver Name right now. There is just threat after threat, but this is a really strong turn for Stan Sivka with Polymorph.
This is a huge swing turn.
Polymorph and... AI ping is pretty nice.
Yeah, the fact that he didn't have to expend his Polymorph onto the Crusher means he can do it now with Rag, and then use Arcane Blast to clear Arcane Explosion, to clear most of this. Fortunately, Silver Name is playing Grom as well, which I usually think is quite greedy to play both 8 drops, but he's decided, I'm going to play this against Reno Mage, have all of the late game, and it's going to be hard for you to outvalue me. And, the Azure Drake. Yeah. It means he doesn't get the card draw from it, but it does put an Azure Drake on the board.
Yeah. I mean, sure, like, small-time Buccaneer probably would have been the best outcome for him, but, you know, Fierce Monkey and Drake, fairly similar. Fierce Monkey, slightly smaller minion, but still leaves the card draw Battlecry in hand. He's also, very importantly, pulled the last dragon out of Silver Name's hand, so that Blackwing Corruptor is not live.
Yep, and Forbidden Flame could be used to take care of his Grom. It works pretty well, because you can ping the Azure Drake and then Forbidden Flame.
Yes.
So Stan's actually pulling his way back in this game, and that's a heal mechanic, so that's useful. He picks up Reno soon. He might have a good chance. And this is the last game of the series, remember, so it's getting pretty tense now.
It really, really is. And most of the big boys from Silvername have been dealt with by Stan Sifka.
Yeah, they have.
Draconid Crusher, Rag, Grom, all gone down at this point, so it's mostly just a few mid-range things that are left.
Doomsayer is okay, but I don't think, you want to develop first, and having the double heal is actually quite huge, because now it means there's not really any world where Silvername is able to pop the block.
I wonder how many dragons he has left in his deck at this point. Yeah, just picking up more dragon activated cards, but has no activators to go with them right now. Just plays a 5/4 just to have the board threat, needs it at this point.
And he plays that as well, yeah. Okay. And this is fine, just having the board. And now Flame Strike is probably just going to seal out the game, because like, he still has it in his deck. That's also pretty good.
I just saw 7 mana, a spell, and then some fire come out of the deck, and I was terrified for Silvername, but it was Firelands Portal.
Oh, unfortunately, he did get one of the worst 5 drops.
Yeah, at least it's not Bomb Squad.
It's not Bomb Squad.
Yeah.
Corkron's good, it pushes damage. Now Stan's down to like low health, he's on 3 health. Which means he's dead too, if he can't clear all of this. Scooze is not useful. And he can't actually clear the whole board, which means the Ice Block is going to get popped next turn.
So this seems weird, but I believe the correct play is to leave only the Corkron Elite alive this turn. No, it doesn't matter, right? Because he just Hero Powers first. Yeah, I was trying to find a way to get yourself not popped out. Do you use Refreshment Vendor?
Ballast Tome into some spell to...
He used his tome already as well, right? He got the Forbidden Flame, etc.
He did. So is this Reno or Bust?
This is Reno or Bust, I believe. I don't think there's even a Farseer in Sifka's list that can save him. Ooh, hello! That works!
Oh my god, if he can get... So close.
Well, you can play your own Doomsayer and silence it to go out with a bang. That's at least reasonable.
That was a really intense series. That was the closest series we've seen in this tournament so far, I'm going to say.
Yeah, definitely right the way down to the wire. Sifka did hit that Kazakus, which I said was quite often defining in the matchup, but he didn't get the full juice. He only got a half cup of juice out of it. Didn't get the full AoE, so just ended up taking too much.